phone. I don't hear an echo anymore, do I? No, it's been solved. Good.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us here tonight for this community conversation. With me is the City Council President, Ben Stuckert, and our Park Board's President, Randy Cameron. All three of us are here to answer your questions about something that's very important coming in front of our community over the next several months. We're joined by participants on the phone and also in the audience here in the City Council chambers, and followers on Facebook and Twitter, and others are watching our conversation live on City Cable 5. We're talking about the City of Spokane's proposal to make an ongoing investment in our streets and the first infrastructure investment in Riverfront Park for over 40 years. We propose separate funding mechanisms for streets and the park's work. It's a pay-as-you-go approach for the street improvements. We proposed a 20-year levy design to provide significant new street work for the same amount of money that Spokane residents pay today for such repairs. With local, state, and federal match funds, the plan would create about $25 million annually for the 25 years in question for the street funding, the same 57 cents per $1,000 of property value Spokane residents currently pay. So it keeps it at the same rate. The investment in Riverfront Park is better served by a traditional bond approach. The Spokane Parks Board just last week approved a master plan to update Riverfront Park. The citizen board also recommend that the City Council place a $60 million bond measure on the ballot this fall to fund those improvements while paying off the existing debt. Tonight's discussion is part of an ongoing conversation about the strategic refinancing proposal. Feedback so far has been instructive and helpful and really helps us craft what we're doing forward, what we're going to put together in the coming weeks. The community has told us it wants further clarity on which streets we intend to maintain and rebuild. Last week, we released a plan. It includes several specific projects during the first 2 years with a focus on our arterial streets. Our goal over the next 20 years is to complete some repair or maintenance work on all 266 miles of arterials. The levy will also allow the city to double the amount it spends on residential street repair by directing some of the dollars currently spent on your arterials to our residential areas. Work will be prioritized based on factors that include pavement condition, traffic volumes, economic development opportunities, pedestrian and bike plan priorities, transit needs, and safety and collision data. We encourage you to tweet your suggestion of street repair projects to the hashtag #TweetYourStreet. You'll be asked throughout this evening to provide feedback on the streets and parks plans. You can also send comments to us at Spokane City on Facebook and Twitter, and to streetsandparks@spokanecity.org. Again, you can email us at streetsandparks@spokanecity.org. A full library of information about both proposals is available on our website, spokanecity.org. You can also leave feedback and comments there. The refinancing proposal for streets and Riverfront Park is another component of the strategy to align needs and resources while really keeping our services affordable to our citizens. And again, tonight, you'll be able to ask questions. Please dial 0 if you have a question to ask, and we'll get you queued up so that we can answer those questions. You know, over the last several weeks, the council president and I have been out talking to citizens. And Ben, I was wondering if you could share with the group some of the things that you and I have been hearing from our citizens.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mayor Condon. Citizens consistently remind us how important the streets are to them. They also talk about reinvigorating Riverfront Park, which has become a great community asset over the past four decades. They want us to maintain what we have and make improvements to the street and park systems. This proposal meets both of those needs and fulfills an important citizen priority. It delivers a sustainable funding solution for street maintenance and repairs and enhancements to our transportation system. It also provides an affordable model for adding new features and a better Riverfront Park experience. The best part of this funding proposal, it can be done within our existing rate structure and without asking citizens to pay more. To me, this is smart government at its best. The current economic climate allows us to accomplish this by refinancing our existing debt, just like you would refinance your home, and deliver funding for two of our important community priorities.
And as the Park Board President, I'd like to say a few words. While Riverfront Park and its settings possess a timeless beauty, many of the facilities are outdated and have fallen into disrepair, and in some cases have been forced to close. Riverfront Park has had no significant capital investment since Expo 74. With the decaying infrastructure that affects its bridges, power, mechanical, and irrigation systems, the park is more than showing its age. The City of Spokane Park Board approved resolutions supporting a new master plan for Riverfront Park, and we were unanimous in supporting a $60 million bond to pay for implementation of the plan. The master plan outlines plans for the park for the next 20 years. It is the result of a two-year process that has engaged more than 1,000 people in its development. The result is improved safety, access, lighting, and amenities that give people new ways to use the park and more people more reasons to come to the park.
And so thank you for those of you on the phone, those of you watching on television or following us on Facebook, to give us a little bit of time to start this conversation. But why we're really here today and this evening is to hear from you. And so I know if you can, if you're on the phone, you can press zero and ask your question and you'll get set up to ask it to us directly. And tell us what's on your mind, tell us what's important to you, ask us questions of what is in front of our voters come this fall. With that, Kurt, do we have any callers on the line now?
We do. We do have callers on the line already, and we're going to take Randall in just a second. Again, I did want to remind people, if you did have a question, just like Randall did, press 00 on the keypad on your phone. And if you'd like to provide us your email address, you need to press 7. We have people standing by to take down your email address so you can be kept up to date on matters electronically. Randall, as I said, is first. Welcome. Welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Where in the city you're from, and what's your question, please?
First of all, my name is Wendell, not Randall. Wendell, like Wendell Fordtown.
Okay. Sorry, Wendell. Go ahead, please.
Okay. My question is why are we even considering putting money into the park when our roads are so bad that driving down to the park, you're lucky if you don't knock a wheel off?
Well, Wendell, that's a great question. And one of the things that we're doing is refinancing two current park bonds. And those that money has already been invested by the community in the parks. And so we're not able to refinance park bonds and spend that money on streets. So really this is an opportunity to take, you know, just like you would a house and you've got a high interest rate, refinance that and then reinvest that money for the same amount that you as a citizen are paying every year back into those parks, just like you would your house.
And back to the streets, you're exactly right. Streets often is a top priority of our community. And that's why after we had a successful 10-year street bond that is currently closing up, but the reality is we're paying for another 10 years on that. And by going to a levy, we now will be looking at about $25 million a year for 20 years. And so the magnitude of dollars is more in the tune of north of $450 million over 20 years. So when you talk about the priorities, not only what the council president talked about of really those dollars that have been allocated to the parks, continued to be allocated to the parks, but on the street side, I couldn't agree with you more. That is a number one priority of our citizens of really looking at our streets, and we're putting those dollars there, looking at a much larger budget for our streets than we ever have by keeping the rate the same, the 57 cents per thousand assessed value the same. So I think it aligns with what you're talking about. And Wendell, many people have had that question. These are two different measures on the ballot. And so people will have the opportunity to vote on both of those, but one is not in replace or the other. They really are two different measures that total the 91 cents that people currently pay. It just is a better way to fund both of those, but allocate them the way they previously had been allocated. Kurt, are we ready for
and
the next?
Before we take our next question, for the people who just joined us, I wanted to remind people to press 00 on the keypad on your phone if you had a question of us, 0 on the keypad on your phone. We're not going to take Larry next. Larry, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Larry, what part of town are you from, and what's your question, please?
North part of town. My question is, why would we put money in Riverfront Park and give our park staff and our park board the ability to botch Riverfront Park some more? But my biggest problem with Riverfront is not with Riverfront Park, but rather with Merkel and the fact that They have raised prices at Merkel to the point of driving almost trying to kill softball. Our teams can't afford the prices that they've charged. They are charging, and now we want more. We want to put money in Riverfront. We need to bring prices down at Merkel so that our kids can play softball.
Thanks, Larry. Great observation and comment. And that's certainly a challenge that we have on the board. And Merkel is certainly not directly related to Riverfront Park, but it's part of the park system, which the board and senior park staff are equally compassionate about. It's always been a challenge to have the right balance of fees and programming. We certainly aren't designing the program fees, league fees, for any type of profit. We're trying to at least reduce the amount of loss to a palatable amount. So we're constantly working on that. One of the things that makes it real helpful is when we're able to do more of the maintenance ourselves, and as we grow the leagues, more participants, we're able to share the costs and actually reduce that. So you'll start to see more of a flat line on those type of programs in the years to come. When we talk about investing Riverfront Park, there's a couple things that we need to take a look at. And one is that so many of the structures were not designed to be used and maintained for 40 years. That's an important piece that we just don't have the budget to have the capital expenditures needed to build new structures, more economical, sustainable structures. For example, Louvre Carousel, it was never built and designed for the carousel to be there for 40 years. So no matter what people want to do, the reality of it is that structure is about ready to be decommissioned. It doesn't have a HVA system. It doesn't have the bones, if you will, to maintain that structure. It's not big enough. It's so popular. You got a quarter of a million people that use Louvre Carousel. And it's not ADA compliant. There's so many things that we need that would actually help drive revenue, not only for Riverfront Park, for the park system, but also the economic part of that. So, and as you can probably tell, I'm real passionate about all the advantages to it. We have the budget in parks to maintain the facilities. We don't have the budget to build the new facilities to take us to the next 40 years. I'll follow one more with that, Larry, and that is when on the economic side, the tourist side, Riverfront Park is the largest tourist attraction. 2.2 million people come to Riverfront Park every year. And of those 2.2 million people, the statistic is almost $575 per person is spent in our hotels, shopping, dining, enjoying other parts of our city. So it does bring people in, and it drives more revenue for our businesses in and around downtown Spokane. And obviously that increases the tax base. We're taking advantage of that as a community.
Let's take another question. I want to remind people again that just joined us, please press 00 on the keypad on your phone if you have a question. And press 7 on the keypad on your phone if you want to provide us your email address. Our first survey question of the night goes like this. I got a little bit of an intro first before you vote. Press 1, 2, or 3. Here goes. Our budget work is tied to some very important principles. There are 6 of them, and they are: don't spend more than you take in, don't pay for ongoing expenses with one-time money, maintain prudent budget reserves, maintain strict controls on hiring and spending, fund the highest priority city services first, use a 6-year budget forecast as a foundation for all future budget discussions. Do you agree with these principles is the question. If you completely agree, press 1. Press 1 on the keypad on your phone. If you somewhat agree, press 2. Not at all, press 3. We really appreciate your participation. While you're voting, we're going to take Stephanie. Stephanie, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Stephanie, what part of the town are you from, and what's your question?
Hi, I just moved into Kendall Yards. I moved here from New York.
Nice. Welcome to Spokane.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I just moved here from New York. My name is Stephanie. I moved to Kendall Yards, the new project on the Monroe Street and Maple Street, the mid-range there.
So, Stephanie, what's your question, please?
Well, my question is, being someone who came from New York where there was a very large yard, Central Park, I am thoroughly interested in the development of the Riverside Park because I see Spokane as a jewel box. It's a place, it's a destination, and it hasn't been developed yet as such. And I would like to see it go that way.
Well, Stephanie, thank you for that comment. And that's truly what began this process nearly 2 years ago as the Park Board and the citizen leadership of the Park Board embarked on and many different plans that looked at Riverfront Park. And we went through a public process over the last year, chaired by Ted McGregor from the Inlander of really many other citizens, to advise and to inform the Park Board on what that should look like. And we have talked to well over thousands of citizens on this subject and really engaged them to see what are those components that make what the park should look like for the next 40 years. And so it's exciting to see the Park Board take this leadership. As our finance team came together, we said, as our principals, as you just heard, as we ask you to give us your opinion on, keeping the rate the same, how can we make that major investment on the 40-year anniversary of Riverfront Park for kids into the future, for adults into the future? Last year we made a strategic investment thanks to our colleagues in the state government on the extension of the Centennial Trail, which leads you right now into Riverfront Park. You see even this weekend, Hoop Fest and the amazing things that our community comes together, and investments not only in the Loof Carousel that the president of the Park Board talked about, but really redoing the pavilion so that we can bring those community events into the center part of our park, enhance those, and in a real way maybe even expand into other events, and would be love to hear ideas. Many of us, of course, have visited New York, but from residents of New York, of other great festivals that happen there and really across our country that we may want to do and celebrate in our own community.
Let's take another question from the audience if we can. It's going to be from Tim. Tim, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Tim, what neighborhood are you from, and what's your question, please?
I'm in the Indian Trail neighborhood. And my question is about the ice rink you guys are planning down there. I think it's a great location for it, but what I'm concerned about is that the viability of only being able to use that facility of 4 months a year.
Great question, Tim, and that's one of the things that we looked at carefully to not only have ice rink, but a strategic location. So for those that may not know, we're talking about relocating it from underneath the U.S. Pavilion to just under the shadow of City Hall, which would be the west corner of Riverfront Park, around the Bloomsday statues. We call that the Gondola Meadows. Why there? One is this is an exciting place. Will be viewed by so many people as you go down Spokane Falls Boulevard and they go into the parkade parking and so on. But the new technologies that are out there now, you might know that even in Phoenix, they're skating year round. So the season, surprisingly, in that location, you don't have the direct sun for so much of the season. We can do that for more than 6 months out of the year. Then it quickly transitions into a plaza that we can do so many things, so many type of programming, whether there's some small events, some markets, some concerts, and that type of thing. What you don't have, you'll have something that's wildly popular like Hoop Fest this weekend. If you'd come down and look at the area after a large event like Hoop Fest, Bloomsday, and Pig Out in the Park, it is just crushed. The grass is, it takes months for it to come back. We have to fence that off. So it really, to have it the way it is right now, isn't, we're not maximizing the usability of it. So we're excited about that. The technology's there to have it. The location is perfect for it. We feel it's going to be a Rockefeller Plaza experience during the winter season and early spring, late fall.
Let's do another survey question if we can. I'm going to make a statement. We want to see how you feel about it. I approve of planning flexibility for street improvements that would consider utility infrastructure, stormwater management, economic development, pedestrian/bike elements, and mass transit. So do you agree with this statement? If you completely agree with this statement, press 1. Somewhat, press 2. Not at all, press 3. Meanwhile, let's take Lori. Lori, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Lori, go ahead with your question, please.
Yes, my question is, when I first read in the newspaper that $60 million just seems huge and horrendous to be spending when we look at our street projects as they go on and our streets are so bad. But I did learn from this conversation and from listening is that it's really important that we keep our carousel going. But our park, I've been here 25 years from Los Angeles, and still the one thing about our park is the beauty is that it's still just a beautiful natural park. It what they did in Coeur d'Alene and it's for Tubbs Hill, it's new and it's modern, and I'm sure it's bringing in money, but you've lost some of the beauty of the park. So that's my question is, $60 million seems like so much to be putting into that park.
Go ahead, please.
So the $20 million that we're putting into streets is annually, and so that'll be for 20 years. So it's about, I think, be between $20 and $25 million a year on the streets. So it'll be a total of $450 million for our streets. The $60 million is just on Riverfront Park, and if we look at Tacoma, which just invested in their riverfront area, and they just spent $240 million, I think the $60 million is quite modest. And I think the fact that this is the 40th anniversary of Expo 74, and we haven't invested in 40 years in Riverfront Park, and I think there are a lot of different areas where we're going to beautify the park. We're actually creating more green space in the park. And so we're not cementing it over. We're actually beautifying the whole entire area. I think that the 2.2 million visitors that come and visit Riverfront Park, and Randy mentioned that earlier, and I think it's really important to remember that this is the biggest draw to our community, and we're at the center of our area. We're the draw for all the people in northern Idaho and in southeastern Washington, and so we need the heart of our city, which is why we're here, is because of the river, and we need to showcase that and show that off. And by not investing in it in the last 40 years, I think we've done a bit of a disservice. So I think $60 million in a bond that, and it's not like that's going to raise taxes. This is a refinancing that's going to keep your taxes that you pay at the same level. So if we vote no on this, you're still going to be paying the same amount. We're just not going to be getting the investment in our park. And it's really important to remember that this yes vote just refinances, and a no vote means you're paying the same. You're just not getting anything for that. And that's, I think it's really important to remember.
And just you'll see with the master plan, and those, if you go to SpokaneCity.org, and those that are just joining us as we talk about the street levy and the park bond, you can go to SpokaneCity.org, see what the master plans are, and you'll also notice that the park plan is turning towards the river. You'll see many more vistas of the river. Those of you that have not come downtown to come to City Hall Plaza and Huntington Park, here is an example of when we went back, relooked it, we took out a parking lot, added parking on the street, diagonal parking, and really invested in that area thanks to those that put it in through a vista. And to see the people come back and view the rivers, that is a similar design and concept that the master plan contemplates, of really making the vistas of the river, making the trails closer to the river, redoing and making the bridges, bringing the maintenance up to a level that allows us to use them more readily. So the rate of 34 cents stays the same. Yes, any of these numbers seem astronomical to many of us, but as you we talk about 266 miles of arterials, and you talk about one of the largest park asset that we have, and the investment that this community has made, the reality is, as we continue to do that over the next 20 years, not only for our visitors, and I couldn't agree with us more as we bring the visitors, but for our own citizens that come from whether it be 5 Mile or Indian Trail or Hilliard or the South Hill or Eagle Ridge, is to really have a centerpiece for so many of our events. Like I would say, I look out my windows here at City Hall and see our community coming together in Hoop Fest and making sure we have the right park to host those types of events.
Our next survey question starts like this with a statement: I am supportive of reinvesting the 57 cents per $1,000 of property value I pay for today in street rehabilitation and maintenance. So the question is, do you agree with this statement? If you do completely, press 1. Somewhat, press 2. Not at all, press 3. Meanwhile, we'll take Carol. Carol, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Oh, I got June. June, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. June, go ahead with your question, please.
Thank you. I'm in the Indian Trail area. I was just wondering if the homeowners property tax are going to be tapped into.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that question, June.
Well, I'm in the Indian Trail area. Will our property taxes go up with all this improvement we're talking about?
The rate stays the same. You're currently paying 91 cents, 57 cents for streets, and 34 cents for parks, and so those the rate per thousand stays the same.
All right, let's take Carol this time if we can. Carol, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Carol, what part of town you're from, and what's your question, please?
Thank you. I'm from the Shadle Park area, and my question is regarding the taxes, the property taxes. You know, the homeowners aren't the only ones that frequent the park. And we've got so many apartments and condominiums and townhouses going up. Is there any way to start including them in participating and paying for these parks?
Absolutely. Their property is assessed. Of course, they do not, and businesses also will, pay this assessed value. The assessed value is across business, apartment owners, and homeowners across the board. Of course, a renter pays that in lieu of, through their monthly rent, but the owner of that apartment complex is paying those taxes, and of course, those are paid by renters by way of their monthly rent.
Survey question number 4. It's very simple. I am in favor of rehabilitating and improving Riverfront Park. If you believe that statement completely, press 1. Somewhat, press 2. Not at all, press 3. I am in favor of rehabilitating and improving Riverfront Park. 1, completely. 2, somewhat. 3, not at all. And I'm going to take Millie next. Millie, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Millie, where are you from? What's your question, please?
Oh, I'm right here in Spokane, Washington, although I was born in Albany, New York, and I sort of migrated around the country, and I was in Albany.
Millie, the question is, where in Spokane are you from?
Oh, where I'm just Spokane. Where am I from?
No, Millie, let's just try the question. What's the question you wanted, please?
Oh, the question I'm always looking out the window. The trees are so heavy with big branches and everything, and is the city responsible for the trees to be, I mean, these are bending over practically over other people's houses.
Mayor?
Well, of course, trees, if they're in the public right-of-way, we have an urban forestry department that maintains those. But if they're in private property, no. So if you do have any concerns about the trees, please do email us here at the City Hall. And you can, the easiest one is mayor@spokanecity.org, or you can call right down to City Hall, 625-6250 for those. So
we've got two more survey questions we want to get in tonight if we can. Let me go with the next one if I might. It's a statement first. I am supportive of reinvesting the 34 cents per $1,000 of property value I pay today to improve and update Riverfront Park. If you completely agree with that statement, press 1, somewhat, press 2, not at all, press 3. While you're voting, we're going to take Greg. Greg, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Where in Spokane are you from, and what's your question, please?
I'm from the Shadle area, and I really had more of a statement than a question. I hear from other people, too, that say that, you know, we should be investing the monies in the road instead of Riverfront Park, but I just kind of take it as two separate issues. I mean, I think everybody agrees the roads need repair, but I just don't understand if anybody's been to Riverfront Park or been to other cities that have, you know, parks in their downtown, what value it could be if we did reinvest that money into Riverfront Park, and I think it is long overdue, and I just think it sounds like a great idea. It's kind of a win-win for the city. So I guess it's more of a statement than a question, and I just appreciate the opportunity for us to actually vote on something that would be improving the city. So although I do agree, I do think the roads are in desperate need of repair, but let's kind of take them on separate issues, I guess.
Greg, I think you just came up with our campaign slogan, so I appreciate that and couldn't agree with you more.
Oh, that's great. The last survey question of the night is quite simple. I support continued citizen oversight and accountability of these programs through a Citizen Transportation Commission and the Park Board. Do you agree with that completely? Press 1. Somewhat. Press 2. Not at all. Press 3. We really appreciate your input. Meanwhile, we're going to take Alice. Alice, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Alice, what neighborhood are you from in Spokane, and what is your question, please?
Yeah, hi there. Thank you for taking my call. I'm on Five Mile Prairie. And my question actually concerns our park up here, Sky Prairie Park, which was built in 1998. I do support improving Riverfront Park. It's one of my favorite places to go. But the park up here has, you know, virtually sat for years without improvements. And so I want to know what the plans are to improve this park.
We're going to bring Leroy Eady, the parks director, up, and he can give us a more of a comprehensive on plan on and strategy on that.
Well, hi, Alice. Thanks for your question. Again, my name is Leroy. I'm the Parks and Recreation Director, and your question about Sky Prairie Park and making investments, we actually have our parks planner, Garrett Jones, is working with your neighborhood just now over the summer on some plans for Sky Prairie Park. As you know, impact fees were collected for Sky Prairie Park as 5 Mile was developed. So we're holding some funds that have been collected over time, and then we're ready to make that investment into Sky Prairie Park. So I highly encourage you to get involved with your neighborhood or check in with your neighborhood. That's who we're working with right now, the 5 Mile neighborhood, and you're going to see some improvements to Sky Prairie. And again, thanks for your support for Riverfront Park.
And this question came in earlier today, and it comes from Dan, and the question goes like this: do we plant street trees in our swales?
Leroy, why don't you take that one also?
All right. Well, the question is, do we plant street trees in our swales? And we do, but it does depend on, it's important on how you design the location of the street trees, and it somewhat depends on the depth of the swale. So you can't drown the trees in the swale. They can take a certain amount of water. But sometimes we'll mound the trees up inside the swale. They're sitting up a little higher, so they're not sitting in the water. And then it kind of just depends on how well the swale, how well the drainage is in the location. So it just depends a little bit on the site, but yes, we do under certain circumstances.
And what's really exciting about the street levy and the integrated plan, which really is our Link Spokane initiative, and those of you watching on television saw the graphic that really shows the three dimensions of our streets, and really to look at them holistically, use them in a way with our stormwater utility to minimize the overflow of our stormwater into the Spokane River. And this is critical as we bring the health back to our river, and really interlocks that with our quality of life and our quality of our water in the Spokane River. And what's exciting in this initiative, especially on the street levy, but really integrated even into Riverfront Park in this case, is where we can utilize those resources and have the opportunity between our utility and our streets department to take on these issues. And people will see many more streets in a fashion that'll be similar to High Drive that'll be done this summer, and where you'll see amenities like different paths or multimodal, whether it be bike or pedestrian, and many other attributes that include managing of our stormwater.
How many trees have you vowed to plant in the next
year? We have, as part of Vision 2020, we are planting 10,000 trees to really enhance our canopy, but also to take care of the stormwater runoff in our community. So you'll see a lot of hardscape, whether it be cement or otherwise, leaving as we put in those more trees. You'll see just in April, we looked at some of our medians there on North, was it Monroe, I believe, where we started putting in those trees. So it's an exciting prospect as we continue to build out our city, just as the, especially as the city council announced our new official, or our official tree, the pine tree.
This will be the last ask for this. If you have a question, please press 00 on the keypad on your phone. And if you want to provide us your email address so you can get email updates, press 77 on the keypad on your phone. Next, we're going to take John. John, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. John, what neighborhood are you from? And what's your question, please? Oh, I lost John. John fell off the board as soon as I picked him up, so we're going to take Jane next. Jane, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. We'll wait for Jane to queue up. I think John's kind of in the in a state of flux. So while we're doing that, let me ask a question that came in earlier today. Why is reinvigorating Riverfront Park so important?
Well, Kurt, I think we talked a little bit about the economic side of it as for the tax revenue, the business revenue from the $2.2 million that'll come into Spokane and visit Riverfront Park every year. The other parts of that, I think, are just as important. You've got a tremendous park. It's in the middle of our city. It's beautiful views of the Spokane River and the falls that everyone wants to come and see and enjoy. But also part of that is that at night, you just don't feel as comfortable. So the investment in the infrastructure is about making it as safe and comfortable at night as it is during the day. So not only are we enjoying the park, increasing the green space, like Council President Stuckert mentioned earlier tonight, but also having that careful blend of amenities that are sustainable, that are popular. We haven't talked about the U.S. Pavilion. Part of the plan is to have that recovered with the newest materials so we can have light and projection without distortion. And if you want an example, it would be similar to the Sydney Opera House. So it can be another beacon for our city from all four corners. We talk about all the events that could go under there, with whether it's going to be the Hoop Fest championship game, the awards. There can also be farmers markets, reunions, concerts, all types of things that we can use. And the people, our citizens and visitors, can participate in. We talked about the ice palace or the ice skate rink, upgrades in the sky ride. There's just so many of the facilities. Two other pieces that we are really excited about too, and that's the structures, rentable structures that are going to be on the river. So you're able to enjoy the river right up to the bank and have events there, whether it's family reunions, business gatherings, and so on. So there's all types of activities that are going to be in and around the park. The promenade, so you have a nice flow from north to south. We also have a cross corridor going east to west, blending the amenities with that green space, and again, making it just as safe, just as enjoyable at night as it is during the day.
Thank you, sir. Well, let's try this again if we can. Let's try and take Jerry if we can. Jerry, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Jerry, what neighborhood are you from? What's your question, please?
I grew up on the north side. My question is we've got employees for the city of Spokane to do some of the road work, but by the time you take their pensions, their wages, all the equipment that we buy, why aren't we just doing business with local companies that do this for a living and save ourselves all that money?
Well, that is a good question, and Jan Quintral, who is in charge of our business developer services, is here with us tonight and can answer some of those questions. And the reality is we do use the best of both our city employees, but also much of the work is done by the private sector.
Exactly. Our street department primarily does maintenance work. They do some of our grind and overlays. They repaint crosswalks and do striping. But our big rebuild jobs and some of the other larger jobs are all bid out to local contractors.
And often you'll see on the street those contractors and their trucks, and they really work closely with our streets department. And so I think it's the right way of doing it. The mix is the right way, because of course after the summer of making sure we're doing crack seal and grind and overlay, a lot of those same workers are the ones plowing our streets, maintaining those streets in the fall because of our great trees. Of course, we have to pick up a lot of those leaves. And so it really is year-round work that the employees of City Hall and the Streets Department does. But then you do that and you partner with the private sector, and they're the ones that do the majority of the work in the summer, especially the major build-outs.
Then on the Transportation Benefit District, 2 years ago, we did a pilot where we used city workers for one grind and overlay, and then we hired it out to a private firm for the grind and overlay, and the cost was, contrary to popular belief, it was about exactly even. And so if somebody can have work working for the city and earn a good pension and a good living wage, then they're contributing back to our community if there's work for them at the city, whether that's plowing or others. Or if it makes sense and it's overage that's only going to be work done during the summer, then we go out to private industry.
And those of you guys that are concerned about streets, I mentioned it earlier, but I do encourage you, as we build out what streets we're doing and we focus on the arterials, there still is a great opportunity for our citizens to tweet your street. You can do that at Spokane City on Twitter. So we can start getting feedback in that mechanism over Twitter on the issue or the streets that you have concern of as we build the model of what streets we do.
Let's take another question from the audience. Matt, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Matt, what neighborhood are you from? What's your question, please?
I'm from the Indian Trail area. I ride my bike often to downtown. And my question is, what part of this is focusing on adequate bike paths that go down to the park? I mean, I ride with my boys, and it's not very safe. Even getting down to the park, because there's a lot of traversing back and forth and major ways, and so some of them are very unsafe. So what? So my question is around that.
Yeah, and so if you look at current projects that we're doing, whether it's High Drive or Crestline, they're what we're talking about is integrated projects, so that when you go in, you're not just doing curb-to-curb replacement of pavement. You're actually looking at the water lines and the sewer lines, but you're also looking at the sidewalks, you're also looking at street trees, and whether that's on the master bike plan. We have a master bike plan that whenever we go in and do street maintenance or new roads, we're putting in those bike lanes or other infrastructure so that you feel safe. I bike often to work, not as much since I've been at City Hall, but I used to bike quite a bit. And you know, I know that from my house down to downtown, there's areas that are missing. But as the city goes and replaces these arterials, we'll be adding in those bike lanes that are on the master bike plan. And that's part of the integrated plan. So instead of where when we did the street bond in 2004, we said, okay, this is a map and this is what we're going to do over the next 10 years. This way, we're adding a little more flexibility in with a levy, and so we can get matching dollars from the federal government, matching dollars from the state, we can get money from our utility department, and then leverage that so what we're getting is really an integrated, complete street whenever we're doing a street project. And you know, whenever it's a bike path is on the master bike plan, we'll be following that.
So I really encourage you, if you haven't, there is the Bicycle Advisory Board. If you're not a member or if we have openings, I'd really encourage you to participate in that. That board advises us and they've done a lot of work to create the master plan. And if you have comments on that, I'd really encourage you to visit us at SpokaneCity.org. You would and be able to get that master plan. And if you have comments on it, especially from the neighborhood you're coming from, that would be a great way to prioritize some of those streets as we look at opportunities for multimodal transportation across our city.
Let's take another question. This one's going to be from Stephen. Stephen, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Stephen, what neighborhood are you from, and what's your question, please?
Again, my name is Stephen. I'm from the Hilliard area, and I want to know, with all the improvements that are going on, what direction is it going towards for those that are handicapped?
Well, a couple of things. You come from a great part of the city that we use an example a lot in the work that was done on Market Street when we talk about integrated projects and really using different funding sources to get the best out of it. And that's what you'll see in the downtown Hilliard area. And really, one of those key components is the installation of ADA ramps across the city. You see that going on right now as we do a grind and overlay on Grand, is as we do this integrated approach, is to use that opportunity and also to put in those accessibility features. And then also as we build out our streetlight infrastructure and as we put in the new crosswalks and really look at it in a holistic approach. And really, as we look going forward, we've talked about, and there was a survey question tonight about having citizen oversight. And there's a lot of robust discussion that the council president and I have had of who, and really working with citizens of what is the makeup of that oversight committee, and having somebody from the disability community would be critical to make sure we're taking that into account going forward.
We had a question actually come in from Facebook. And the question, I don't know who it's from, but here's the question. Are maintenance plans costs included in the Riverfront Park plan? And again, this was from Facebook.
Well, great question. And to understand the difference between the levy and the bond is designed for capital expenditures, capital improvements. So it's for building. So bond for building, levy for building, but also maintaining. So our strategic plan not only is to have the new structures that are sustainable, there has to be a solid business plan, and in many of the cases have to have a revenue stream that's acceptable, again, sustainable. We have a budget to maintain, and actually when we take fewer buildings, remove the buildings that are in such disrepair, and even one building that is closed for public use, it's just not safe. So when we start removing those, our maintenance budget actually reduces in Riverfront Park.
Let's take another question. Let's take it from Joseph. Joseph, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Joseph, what neighborhood are you from, and what's your question, please?
Good evening. Joseph, I'm over in the 3rd District. I'd like to give a shout-out to Mayor Condon. I'm holding down the 3rd District, Mayor, and I just wanted to know what was the time limit on the project of the park.
Well, great. Joseph, wish I get some of those shouts out. Our plan is strategic in that some of the facilities we can address right away. The infrastructure is the most important. You're going to see a lot of ground being moved, but we don't want to shut everything down at once and absolutely close the park. So we see it as probably a 5-year plan to make all the infrastructure changes, strategically rebuild a new Loof carousel, covering the U.S. Pavilion, those type of things, without disruption of our major events, too. I mean, it's so important to have Pig Out in the Park continue to expand and entertain the community. Hoop Fest, the list goes on and on. And those are just, you know, some of our large ones with Bloomsday, Hoop Fest, and Pig Out. There are so many second tier as far as people participating that we have to make sure we take care of as well. So it's not all at once, but it's systematic, and we plan it on it being about a 5-year project.
All right, let's take Pat next if we can. Sorry about that. We're going to try and squeeze in as many questions as we can. We've got about 10 minutes left, so here goes. We're going to start with Pat right now. Pat, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Pat, what neighborhood are you from? What's your question, please? Oh, it's Lynn. Lynn popped up. Lynn, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Lynn, what neighborhood are you from? What's your question, please? Lynn? Lynn, I know you're there. Go ahead with your question. I shall read Lynn's question. If you want more attractions to show off the river, we need a park and more green grass activities, etc. Your thoughts, gentlemen?
That's part of the plan. I mean, we can't agree with her any more than that. That's having more areas to view the river, having more spots to get closer to the river. That's all part of the master plan. We've got to talk about amenities and the green space. We've never forgotten the true focus, the biggest entertainment piece, the biggest, most enjoyed piece of Riverfront Park is the river and falls. So we want to have as much access and viewing corridors to the river as we possibly can.
Let's take Pat next if we can. Pat, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Pat, what neighborhood are you from? What's your question, please?
I'm from the East Central community, and I live and work in the budding South University District down on Sprague down there. My question is there a date or in a plan for street improvements between Division and Sherman and beyond on Sprague, and if so, what are they, and what time frame is it for, and will it coincide with the bridge being built across the railroad tracks?
So right now we're looking for funding for the bike pedestrian bridge that'll cross over from the University District on Sherman and cross those railroad tracks. And then if the levee passes, and we're actively looking for funding right now, Sprague between Division and down to Altamont will get a full rebuild with integration. So that means that we'll be working with the water pipes, the sewer pipes, we'll be making sure that the streetscape is taken care of at the same time. Next year in 2015, in between Hamilton and Altamont on, I believe it's First Street, we're doing a whole grind and overlay down there. And then we're spending about $200,000 between Hamilton and Altamont on street improvements as well. But we're looking at, if this levy passes, a full rebuild of Sprague between Division in 2016.
And again, I'd encourage people.
Try and take a couple. Go ahead.
Okay. I'd encourage people to go to SpokaneCity.org. You'll see the projects that are online for the next 2 years. And then really the things that the council president brought up of how we look at the streets going forward. Predominantly, you look at the condition of the streets. We look at economic vitality. We look at the master plan, whether that be for bike and pedestrian. And then also the build out of our infrastructure. Many people don't realize, but we have more pipe in the ground than we have streets. And so we need to maintain that. Much of that infrastructure in our water and our sewer utility is nearing 100 years old and needs to be replaced. And that's what's really key about the Link Spokane initiative. And again, you can go into depth and really get some of those visuals and those plans. Go to SpokaneCity.org, search under Link Spokane, and you'll get a whole library of the work that's being done with the public, with the neighborhoods, and really a great opportunity also to partner with the City Council on the Targeted Investment Program, the TIPS program.
Let's take Jen next. Jen, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. Jen, what neighborhood are you from, and what's your question, please?
My name is Ken. I'm up here on the north side. Just a couple questions in regard. I understand that, you know, the city is looking for revenue, and I agree 100% that Riverfront Park should be expanded, new attractions created or brought in so that people will come down, but the streets are still important because even going downtown, the streets are horrible. And I know that the mayor's doing the best he can with what he's got to work with, but when you have these private contractors that do the streets, where's the guarantee? Where's the warranty? I've seen where Northwest Boulevard in Alberta, the intersection there, they were actually digging wood out of the ground, that they used wood for a base for the streets. And I'm just going like, who's engineering this stuff? Who's inspecting these streets to begin with? Because
we're running out of time. Could somebody answer what Ken was saying?
Yes, I certainly can. This is Jan Quintrell again. In Northwest Boulevard, we found old trolley tracks. Spokane streets are full of surprises. Some of the things we find when we do these major rebuild projects are legendary. And when we rebuild streets now, we do them in a very different way. We go much deeper and remove a lot of those things that will then interfere with the road quality.
That was one heck of a good answer. We're going to take John next. John, welcome to our telephone town hall meeting. John, what area are you from, and what's your question, please?
I'm from Indian Trail, and I'm supporting the park bond project. I'm interested in how the revenue sources split. The part of it is from refinancing the old bond, and I agree wholeheartedly with that. But part of it is also from extending the new bond from 13 to 20 years. So what is the split? How much is from refinancing, and how much is from a longer term?
Thank you for that question, and with us is Rick Romero, who can talk about the financing piece of the park bond.
Okay, thank you. I'm the utilities director for the city, and I work together with our finance department on the funding for this. And about half of the funding of that 57 cents will go for new projects, and about half of it will go for the refinance on the existing bond.
And we have a question from Twitter. Can we use the levy for multi-model improvements?
I think the projects will be integrated, and they're going to include all modes of transportation. It's going to improve the pedestrian environment. It's going to help the environment for bicyclists, help the environment for ADA compliancy, for our STA riders. I think everybody's going to benefit from this streets proposal. I don't see any negatives at all. It's going to help everybody in our community.
And I really encourage people to go to SpokaneCity.org, search Link Spokane, and you'll see what we're talking about as we bring each one of our departments together to really build the best asset for our citizens.
Mayor, it's about time to wrap up, but before we do, I want to remind people that didn't get their questions answered, please leave us a voicemail so we have a chance of getting back to you, but we need your name, your phone number, and preferably your email address so we can get back to you even quicker. But you need to stay to the end of this call if you could to do that. Mayor, hand off who you want to have with final comments, and then you finish up, please.
Okay, do you have any final quick comments?
Sure, thank you, Mayor. Hearing a lot of support. We're still not done with the details, so please stay involved. We'll continue to reach out to the communities and have open forums. I want to say a couple things quickly about when our citizens are talking about local talent, Riverfront Park, the design, master plan design, all local talent. The architect designer for the U.S. Pavilion is from Spokane. He's well known. The contractors, the suppliers, all of this we want to keep inside Spokane. We've got great talent here to design it, to build it, and to maintain it. The last thing I'd like to say is that we've got a park board position opening soon. So if you want to be involved, if you want to be a part of this process, please go to the city website and download the application, and please send it to the mayor's office. We'd love to interview and add another passionate member to the board.
Council President?
I'd just like to finish by saying I think this is what good government's about, both of these proposals. Because whether you vote yes or no, you're going to be paying the same amount on your property tax bill. But if you vote yes, you're going to get $20 million a year towards streets, and you're going to get a $60 million investment in Riverfront Park. People are always talking about how important our parks are, how important our streets are, but that they're tapped out on their taxes. This solves that entire issue. I just think this is, couldn't be prouder to be a representative on the City Council right now.
And again, thank you to all of those that are joining us on Channel 5, on Facebook, and definitely everybody that's on the phone. Thank you for being part of this community conversation. The conversation continues, but please do stay tuned. Watch, come onto SpokaneCity.org to look at the different plans. And at the end, as the council president says, we're keeping the rate the same, making strategic investments like so many homeowners have done over the last several years as they've taken advantage of the interest rates and the position that we are financially. We are doing that here at the city and utilizing those savings and the refinancing in a way that meets the top 2 to 3 priorities of our citizens. It is about streets. We're making that strategic investment with the dollars that you are asking us to. We're making the investment in our parks, and we're continuing to align our priorities with your priorities in a way that is affordable to our citizens, and also most importantly that we're being held accountable. There will be citizen oversight both by the park board and by an oversight transportation committee that make sure that we stay true to our word and make sure that we provide the best assets for our citizens. And again, thank you so much for joining us on television, on Facebook, and on the phone this evening.